And we're about to have the best three of that entire process up on stage in a moment. So what you're basically saying is these are the slackers.
Yeah.
I don't know how they go through. But I'd just love to turn to Tim, Haley, and Chris. I'd love to just ask, you know, you to just introduce yourselves very, very kind of briefly and tell me a little bit about yourself.
Let's introduce each other.
Go for it.
In this order?
Sure, go first, please.
Oh, okay. Is it thundering out? Is
it's
that
thundering. It's a sign.
Wow.
we don't have weather in California, so we're very unaccustomed to this.
It comes and goes very quick, yeah.
So my name is Haley Barnum, and I'm a venture partner at First Draft Capital. I've only been on the dark side as an investor for 3 months. Before this, I was a founder. I co-founded a company called Birchbox, which is a beauty retail e-commerce site.
Kick-ass successful.
Why, thank you.
I'm Tim Chang, Managing Director at Mayfield Fund, one of the early stage venture capital firm in Silicon Valley. Focused on Series A and B investments. I do quite a bit in marketplaces, quantified self, next gen wellness, financial services, and all things body hacking and expanded consciousness.
So are you going to eat beignets while you're here?
This is like nutritional cheat day heaven or hell, depending which program you're at.
I'm Chris Sacca, frequent target of internet harassment through Twitter mentions. I founded my own firm, Lowercase Capital, and a couple years ago I gave it to my partner, Matt Mazzio. He is the guy you want to be pitching while you're here. I'm no longer in charge. He's M-A-Z-Z-E-O. Yeah, when I'm not investing through our fund, I am moonlighting on Shark Tank only for the opportunity to bust Mark Cuban's balls in front of millions of Americans.
Fantastic. By the way, Patty, would it be possible to get a couple beers up here?
Yeah.
We get some, maybe have some beers, please.
Maybe like Coronas with a lime, a twist. No, I mean, not like
that. Okay, we'll get some beers in a few moments. So I'd really love you, of course, some of the startups coming up on stage is the very first time they've ever pitched in front of an audience of this size, in front of judges, in front of investors like this. So I'd, you know, love you to give all of them a huge round of applause when they come up on stage and also when they come off stage as well. So I'd like to welcome the very first startup on stage from Waterloo, Canada. Please welcome Beagle. Yeah.
Hi everyone, my name is Keanu Sullivan. I'm the top dog and founder of Beagle. Now, after I qualified as a lawyer, I decided to focus on business, and that was contract negotiations. I did about $1 billion worth of contract negotiations myself, all sizes and shapes, and with that came expectations, particularly from friends and family who would always ask me to have a quick look at something, usually at a family reunion. Now, a buddy of mine on a Friday said, "Hey, Kian, can you have a quick look at your contract for me? We're going after a big construction job. Just have a quick look for me." I said, "Sure, George, no problem." Well, there I am, Saturday afternoon, page 40, beer number 4, and I realized that this is bullshit. There has to be a better way to comb through this, to give George that quick look. I mean, what was he looking for? He just wants to know, are there anything in there that is going to impact how he's going to price it, or whether he should even go after the job in the first place? So then I thought, if you took 10 lawyers and you put them in a room, and while your first assumption would be to lock them away forever, if you gave them the contract and a highlighter and said, "Can you have a quick look?" what would the outcome be? It'd be surprisingly simpler. Who's responsible for what? How do you get out of it? Who's on the hook for what if things go south? So I said, let's automate it. And we did. Introducing Beagle. It uses artificial intelligence to perform that quick look for you. It's the instant analysis so that you understand exactly what you're doing in that particular contract. Now, any contract decision maker in any size business, small or large, has to understand facts. And 30 million of those businesses in North America don't even use a lawyer to analyze their contracts. So for Beagle, if we have one person in 1% of those companies, that ends up being a $4 billion potential revenue stream. And let's not forget that English is the international language of commerce. So Beagle is truly a global solution. Now let's look at it in action. This is the exact contract George asked me to look at. We identify who's responsible for what, and George can now dive into that and see the clauses in context. And using a secure, social media-inspired collaboration tool, he can engage with all the stakeholders that he wants to get instantaneous and secure feedback. So now George is able to make decisions based on fact and not feeling. Now, from a competitive perspective, we have a huge advantage because we are the only ones that combine the real-time collaboration and the artificial intelligence to provide a truly unified solution. It's kind of like chocolate and peanut butter. It just works better together. And another unfair advantage is we have a fantastic team. We have three data scientists who have masters and PhDs in artificial intelligence, specifically natural language processing and machine learning. We have the business experts and the legal experts, and we're able to combine that experience and expertise to deliver a world-class product. And because of our strategy and our team, we've been able to double our users and double our revenue and strategic partners over the last couple months. And our focus is that contract decision maker. We're kind of like approaching the market like Salesforce. We're an individual productivity tool, but as more people in the organization start to use it, it becomes bigger and growing throughout that company. Now, I want you to be able to not be like George. Don't ruin your friend's weekend. You guys have contracts or NDAs in your inbox right now. All we have to do is forward that to Rufus at Beagle.ai. You're going to get an instantaneous analysis right in your inbox, and you're going to understand what's in that contract. And while I don't hold a grudge, George did ruin my weekend. So now you guys can actually go off and enjoy yours. Oh, and there's actually one more thing. My mom reads Twitter, so if you guys could go to @BeagleInc and send out a tweet, I'd appreciate that.
Nice.
Thank you.
Just from a risk perspective, those 10 lawyers locked in the room, have you let them out yet?
Yeah, they are.
Okay. Do you run into any regulatory issues around faking, you know, like kind of imposing that you're, you know, on the legal profession? It's a heavily regulated licensed profession. You're doing, I saw in the document, you're redlining, so you're actually suggesting other changes. Has anyone pushed back on you and said, you know what, you guys are kind of pretending to be lawyers?
So we're not providing legal advice. The red lines that you saw there, they're actually from the users. It's a platform for them to be able to understand the contract better.
To suggest changes?
We don't suggest changes either. Because what's important to you in a contract is actually going to be what's very, maybe very different than you. You might like perpetual licenses, you might not. So we don't know that. But what's really good is we've got built-in machine learning so that as you use the system, it understands your personalities, what you like and don't like, and then it will start to suggest things only based on your previous usage.
So let's talk about the business model. That sounds like a really good initial lead gen tool. You're doing quick look as analysis. What does that lead to? Is it then an ongoing repeat business? Are you then doing outsourced legal help? Lead gen, marketplace, what sort of goes from there after the quick look?
So it's a great question, and it applies mostly to enterprise. Because what happens here is you now have a breadcrumb trail in how contracts are gone through and how you negotiate or how you deal with a contract. So the analytics that we can give you in determining the probability of one clause changing versus another is something that we'd be able to learn over time. And that's a real high value to big enterprise. There's also corporate compliance and compliance control. So now what often happens in a big enterprise is that a person will say, or it'll be a $50,000 budget provided that the contract doesn't have this provision, and then you have to send it to lawyers.
And how are you charging?
It's a monthly SaaS.
Per seat?
The person who uploads the contract is the one who pays. Everyone that they collaborate with gets to collaborate for free, and NDAs are free for everybody all over the time.
Right. Thank you, Keen, and thank you to Beagle. Okay, so would you please put your hands together, huge round of applause for Rorus from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Props. Yeah, you got props. All right, how's it going, everybody? My name's Kyle Henson from Rorus, and we make very simple, easy-to-use water filters. So 8,000 people die every single day from drinking contaminated water. And usually in the developed world, we think that that's because people in the developing world can't afford clean water tank. And while that's part of the story, it's not the whole picture. If you take a plastic water bottle filled with water and you leave it in the sun for 6 hours, you actually end up with water that's biologically safe to drink. But people don't do this, and people still die because it's super inconvenient. And when we deploy technology like chlorine tablets to alleviate this inconvenience, they're misused because they're not designed to work across language and culture barriers. Chlorine tablets actually have a 50% recontamination rate. Technology that works in the lab often fails in the field. And our solution to that problem is to make water filters that are simple enough for everybody to use every day. And that's a picture of a 5-year-old kid who we met on our pilots in India, and he's been using our filters ever since from the days we went there in February till now. Usability is safety when it comes to water filters. You don't deploy a water tech that doesn't work. People just misuse water tech that does work because it's too complicated. The way that we alleviate this problem is we have filters that work differently from other filters. Most filters work by taking dirty water, forcing it through a membrane with really, really, really tiny holes, and hopefully the pathogens and other things you're trying to remove from the water are caught on one side of the membrane. Our filter has holes that are about 100 times the size of those competitors, and the filter media itself is ionically charged. So as water passes through, it's attracted to the filter and removed from the water. This gives us a really fast flow rate. It works kind of like a drinking fountain in the US. And to demonstrate how confident I am in the technology, I had 25 people spit in here before I came on stage. Got a glass of water. I'm gonna drink in front of you. Cheers.
No, don't do it!
I've used this drink from a toilet, it's cool. So,
Patty, what happens if he collapses over the next 2 minutes?
I have no idea. I don't know what to do.
Well, looks like we've got some technical issues. But, let's see, can that come up soon? Or maybe.
Oh.
Uh-oh. Alright, well, anyway, I'm just gonna add that for you guys.
The filter's better, the holes are bigger, it's ionically charged.
Yeah.
Crank the spit. This is pretty awesome.
So basically, anyway, I forget exactly what was next, so I'm just gonna go a little out of order.
No one knows.
Essentially, a couple highlights. Some of our team members. I was a prior startup co-founder, and I was the CFO of a nonprofit before joining Roars. Our CEO, Corinne Clinch, couldn't be here because she has laryngitis, unfortunately. But she spent the last 5 years in and out of the developing world watching those problems that I just talked to you about, where filter tech fails in the field but works in the lab. She watched that happen, and she herself got Giardia, but there had to be a better way. Our chief microbiologist spent 34 years at the city of Pittsburgh's chief microbiologist, so if you ever visited Pittsburgh and drank clean water, he's the reason why. We're commercializing in the $5.5 billion Indian household water filtration market, and that market's expected to double over the next 15 years. Our newest team member, Dr. Rao, has spent 25 years, he's based in Bangalore, working for companies like Eureka Forbes and other great A-listers to take water tech from the lab to the field. I know there was other stuff. Oh, all right, so our cost of goods picture. We're able to sell this product at a 60% margin, 6-0, and still deliver clean drinking water to the Indian people at about half the cost per liter that they're used to paying right now. And one of the coolest things I think that I can tell you is that we're launching a crowd equity funding campaign. So anyone starting May 16th can invest as little as $100 in Roars and get common stock just like the rest of us have. Super cool. If you want to learn more, check us out at wefunder.com/Roars. And I remember one more thing. That was supposed to be a little earlier in the slides. What we're selling is a cartridge. There's a great picture of it in the deck. But that's the cartridge that's behind the tap right here. And that can turn anything that can carry water into a really simple, really comprehensive water filter, whether it's our backpack that we make and sell, or locally available buckets like you saw with that 5-year-old kid. That's most of what I have to say.
That's a challenge just in this such a situation. Still can continue, it's good.
Yeah, I tried, it was a little out of order.
Never.
Can I just ask one question? You're sick CTO. She didn't get sick from drinking the water, right?
No, my guess actually isn't waterborne as far as I know.
I appreciate your candor.
No, I think the boyfriend's to
blame. You described a pretty diverse team. You know, as diversity is a common topic in our industry right now, both on the investing side and the founding side, do you think this is a product that benefits specifically from having diverse team members with diverse backgrounds and diverse experience in the field?
Yes, absolutely. So the three of us, except for Dr. J, went to Carnegie Mellon, that's where we all met. I studied business. I do have experience founding another company.
company. Corinne really brings the field experience, the field work that kind of leads to this design. And Uriel is like the coolest dude that words can't do justice. His room is just three industrial sewing machines along one wall, a whole bunch of like soft goods crafting materials along another wall, and a workbench on the third wall. And I went in, I was like, wait, where do you sleep? And he pulls a curtain out from under the workbench and his mattress is down. He's built two suits of armor, I think like eight boats, two cars, and that's in high school. So I mean, he's like the coolest prototyper.
Well, those could be ancillary product opportunities.
Yeah, he designed the first prototype for this. Seriously, we got feedback from an NGO, and he designed this first prototype within 6 hours.
So you're selling, your first market is international, global, in the field, to NGOs. Can you talk a little bit about the size of that market and also the sales process? Is it?
Sure. So we are selling to NGOs and also direct to consumer in India, and that's what that consultant I mentioned is really helping us. The NGO market is huge. I mentioned $5.5 billion in India alone, and that's just what the Indian people spend. I think it's another billion when you factor in NGOs, and again, that's all just in India. The total size of this water market is $14 billion, and our technology, I mean, water's everywhere, right? So when you factor in military, government, outdoor recreation in the first world, when you factor in those markets, we're talking at least $18 billion of addressable market with this technology. The sales process? The consultants are really helping us get channel partners. We're going to be working with distributors in India. We have relationships with a lot of NGOs. We actually did that pilot that you saw some pictures from before the tech failed me. We did that with a group called the Emmanuel Hospital Association, and they're really well connected in India as well on the NGO side. So they're really both helping us get to market.
How's your patent portfolio? Have you filed for IP?
Yeah, so we're keeping the technology trade secret because we're really internationally focused. So if you publish this as a patent in the US, you're saying, hey world, that isn't the US, copy this. And other than that though, everything you can see about this bag is patentable. So we've got two utility patents filed and I think we're working on four more.
You feel proud of your work?
Very, yeah. I mean, like I said, that kid is drinking from our filters every day. And along with 50 other people in a village where we did our pilots.
Right on. I think that matters more than anything.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Appreciate it.
Congratulations. I think Carl did incredible despite that mishap. For that to happen on stage, he really, really did incredible. So, next up, was that Microsoft's fault or Adobe? Who fucked that up?
Let's assign some blame.
So, please welcome to the stage from San Diego, California, Portfolium.
Hello, everyone. My name is Adam Markowitz. I'm the founder and CEO at Portfolium, and we're changing the way college students enter the workforce. Roughly 2 million students in the U.S. will graduate from college next month and attempt to enter the workforce. But 60% of employers say they can't find the skills they're looking for in these graduates. And this entry-level skills gap results in more than half of all recent graduates being unemployed or underemployed. And that is a massive problem. But I don't think there's a skills gap at all. I'll repeat it. I don't think there's an entry-level skills gap in this country. This is the highest educated generation in history. That's grown up in the digital age with access to unlimited information literally at their fingertips. So if it's not a skills gap, what is it? It's a data gap. 60% of employers can't find the skills they're looking for because there's nowhere for them to go and actually see all of the skills that students are acquiring. You might think LinkedIn, but less than 13% of millennials actively use LinkedIn. The average age of a LinkedIn user is 46 years old. And the number one reason students don't use it is because they don't have any professional experience. But what do students have? That's the most ironic part. They have work samples. Projects, papers, presentations. 85 years of research said that work samples are the number one indicator of job performance. Above GPA, above what school you went to, even above professional references. So this is the data gap. We still hire students today based on their major and their GPA. When we could be, we should be hiring students based on what they've done and what they can do, the items on the left. Together, these items represent the talent currency of the modern era, and they represent the core of the Portfolium network. On Portfolium, students demonstrate directly to employers all of the work that they've done and the skills they've acquired throughout their academic journey in these portable, permanent learning profiles of record, allowing us to match millions of students with tens of thousands of employers on a level that was never possible before. This is the new talent currency for students. Here's how it works. Portfolium partners with the university and provides every single student with a free, verified e-portfolio. Students upload their work, Their skills are proven, indexed, and then made searchable by employers at scale. It's that simple. Stand by. Over the last 2 years, Portfolio has partnered with over 150 universities to provide these verified portfolios to more than 3 million students, almost 15% of all college students in the country. Now, why do employers care? Despite the fact that $4 billion a year is spent by corporations recruiting 19 million students in the U.S., campus recruiting itself has severely lagged behind the recruitment technology revolution. But not anymore. Today, for the first time ever, employers could search for students with specific skill sets that match the competency profiles of their open positions. We just launched this product earlier this year, and we are strategically serving key early customers in a number of verticals. In fact, today I'm excited to announce that Oracle will be replacing their LinkedIn licenses with Portfolio licenses for their campus recruiters beginning in June. And over the next few months, Portfolio's partner career centers will be providing 15,000 employers with trial access to their campus's network to begin recruiting their students on Portfolio. All of this traction is due to the tireless efforts of our amazing team at Portfolio. Our investors, advisors, and management team have experience in higher education, recruitment software technology, and include some of the earliest employees at Facebook, LinkedIn, and theladders.com. Portfolio is not a job board, it's not just an ePortfolio network. It's a powerful tool that's changing the way millions of students market themselves to employers, and changing the way tens of thousands of employers recruit entry-level talent. I know it's the most overused word in the book, but I really do define that as disruption, and I really think that's the only way to address this entry-level skills gap. Thank you. I might have.
It's not even on the panel, it's annual.
Last year, apparently.
Hey, does your platform give an opportunity to feature crappy jobs that you've had along the way? I mean, there was a guy on the internet, on Twitter a couple days ago, who was saying, like, look, college students, this restaurant experience is not impressing me. And yet, when we hire, I won't hire you unless you've had a tipping or a service or some other shitty job along the way. Is there an opportunity to feature that kind of stuff on your platform?
Of course. So it's not just what you do in the classroom, literally outside the classroom as well. From extracurriculars to part-time jobs to athletics. All these things tell a story about a person, master culture of my company. I still put my restaurant experience on my resume, even recently, because it says a lot about what I've done and the skills I acquired and what I want to do.
Great. How do you charge? What's your business model?
Sure, so we actually charge universities to gain access to dashboards and analytics about what their students are doing, the skills they're showcasing, on the other side what employers are searching for, really identifying that skills gap. But the real bread and butter, we charge, just like LinkedIn, employers to use it as a recruiting platform.
What's the run rate today?
The run rate? We're at 30K MRR right now.
30K MRR, okay.
And 90% of that is from the university partnerships, which again is not the bulk of our revenue long-term.
Was this born of a personal experience of yours?
Yeah. So I started at UCSD in the dorms in 2004 when Facebook had launched. That's a really interesting time to be a freshman in the dorms, seeing everyone get really comfortable sharing all their social activity online. That's kind of the first light bulb moment. But I actually, 4 years later, landed a job working on the space shuttle program by bringing a paper portfolio into my job interview. So I just stapled photographs of the different engineering projects I worked on to the back of my resume. That was the first portfolio profile.
I love it, because when I was hiring at Birchbox, you could ask someone, tell me a story when you did this. If someone took out their iPad or some actual examples of work, like, that was the best. So can you see this extending beyond just, post-college first job, but also to later career?
Definitely. So even when we first launched our first campus, UC San Diego, we had students who were previously denied opportunities due to average GPAs, but then they were able to show how passionate they were and everything they did, and then they started landing these jobs, and that helped us secure a lot more university partnerships really quickly. But now companies are coming to us and saying, after we hire a student, we want to bring their portfolio with them and use a private version for talent management within our own company and see all the skills that our employees are acquiring.
Right on, man. Congrats.
Thank you.
Yes. Awesome. So
in a moment, I'm going to ask the judges to go backstage, and they're going to begin their deliberations. And later this afternoon, we'll come back on stage and we'll announce the winner. But I'd just like to ask you finally to put your hands together for all three of our judges and all of the startups who have participated. Thank you so much.
This is a lot of work.